Accept challenges. Reject norms. Push boundaries. This is Barrow Neurosurgery Basecamp. Your front seat to the teaching rounds of Michael Lawton and Juan Uribe. Join Barrow residents and renowned guests as they seek to understand the most complex, difficult, intricate cases. This is Inside Access you'll find nowhere else. A journey you'll never forget. Come with us as we climb the trail from base camp to the very pinnacle of neurosurgical excellence.
This is the last episode of season two, and it's a great case to end on, especially with Dr. Spetzler here. This episode I call The Torch. It's a giant dolichoectatic basilar apex aneurysm. It's fun to talk about this case with Dr. Spetzler because for decades, and certainly when I was a resident, these were the cases that he was famous for. Patients would fly in from all around the world. We would be doing hypothermic circulatory arrest for these cases to clip them. I was one of the residents in the trenches taking care of them for days afterwards. But it really struck me presenting my case to Dr. Spetzler how the torch had passed. It's so true that residents grow up and become professors. Professors then go on to be chairmen. Mentees grow up to become mentors. And Dr. Spetzler has gone from being chairman here to emeritus professor. The torch has passed. I'm doing what he used to do. We continue as a institution to do these very challenging cases. That's really what struck me today, was just being in this special moment where the generations roll on, and the torch clearly has passed from one generation to the next.
This one is interesting. I'm just curious how you would manage this one. Initially presented with headaches, and that was found. Looked almost like a quadrification dilation, and very rapidly, this is like, I think, a year and a half interval from left image to right image, went from a large to a giant. The other thing on these, you can see she's got some, speaking of younger patients with some underlying dysplasia, she's got these other abnormalities that you can see here.
And I was just about to ask you, I want to see the rest of them, because this is not unusual to see this dysplastic change in the vessel occur in other places as well. These are so bad.
If we were back in 1994, would you have done a circ arrest on that?
No, I don't think so, because I don't see anything to clip. At length, the whole base of that basilar artery system. I mean, you do see the basilar artery under going through there. Are those posterior cerebral, superior cerebellars coming from the dome?
Yeah, so interestingly, this one here comes off of the mid fundus. This one here drops out from underneath. And they're completely diametric here, like they're on the opposite side. So it's a true dolichoectatic, and really hard to imagine any clip reconstruction there.
And do we have any PCOMs at all?
We have PCOMs more on the right than the left.
So, I mean, this is one of those where flow diversion, we're able to see. I mean, I see the posterior cerebrals. I don't see the superior cerebellar arteries.
Yeah, there's a real thread of one there.
Yeah.
And the other one was also coming underneath in there, so very small.
It does look like through the haze of the aneurysm, like the basilar artery does continue on up. Right. I mean, don't you see that?
There's almost like a jet.
Exactly.
Going this way.
Is it a jet or is it artery?
It's a jet.
In fact, when you look at this MR, you can almost see how that jet comes up and the flow curls around like that.
Well, but I think maybe on that one you sort of get the glimpse of the SCAs. I mean, the question is whether there's any chance of being able to clip the basilar artery above the SCAs.
The evolution has been dramatic, and it has been fun to watch this, and it allows us to teach much, much better. They changed dramatically, naturally, because now you have no limit to the number of x-rays you can study, MRI scans, CT, etc., because they're all on a computer and projected. You can look all the way back. You don't lose any films. You've got it all there at your behest. So I can't tell you how frustrated we used to be because films were lost. Some attending or some resident or some nurse would take the films, bring them somewhere thinking that that's where they needed to be, and then when we really needed them, they couldn't be found. So that's an incredible advantage. The second thing is that with technology, not only do you have an endless supply of whatever information is pertinent to the patient, but you also have the ability to immediately go online and seek an answer from some expert somewhere else, some reference that you can do, some anatomical picture that is pertinent to this particular case.
Below the anesthesia.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's how I was thinking about this, was to basically do a flow reversal, Hunterian ligation here. And I am always a little nervous not doing some kind of bypass unless the PCOMs are really strong. And in her case, I wasn't convinced. And I also felt like this PCA was really odd, the way it was so up. So I went for that, and we actually had a little help because she had an arachnoid cyst in the front here that gave us a little extra room here. You can see this is all aneurysm here. This is 3. This is aneurysm here. It's all kind of going this way. This is the tentorium. Through that pretemporal exposure, it was able to find the PCA outflow. So that's our PCA coming out. And what I'm trying to do here is just get in a radial artery graft. So this is our graft here coming out. And I'm going into this recipient site with the idea of
being end-to-end.
End-to-side.
End-to-side.
So the idea would be an M2-P2 bypass so that we create our own super PCOM on this left side. And that way we can go down and do our Hunterian ligation. And then the thought
being, why not end to end?
Well, I wanted flow to go both back to the PCA, but also across to the other side. I was trying to flow reverse so that the flow would go from left to right through the aneurysm.
So the PC, the PCOM on the other side was, you didn't think was adequate to?
Yeah, the PCOM on the other side was pretty small. Yeah, in retrospect, what we did, we actually achieved a really nice flow reversal where her aneurysm kind of came up like this. We had the left PCA and the right PCA. And the thought was, if we put in our bypass like this and revascularized here, then we would get flow antegrade, and then we would get flow reversal here and across, and then we could clip occlude like this below the SCAs. That was the thinking. And I wanted to make sure that I took care of whatever thalamal perforators were there by keeping that flow across. Now, what actually turned out to happen was that the PCOM over here on the right side was, it sort of came to life. And what ended up happening was that this, as this thrombosed, turn this into a, we'll call thrombus sort of blue. This started to lay down thrombus like this, and ultimately it kind of sealed off in here where PCOM took over and took care of the right side and the bypass took care of the left. And we ended up losing that central part of the aneurysm to the clot, and she ended up having a little stroke.
And the stroke came from one of the thalamic perforators.
So here's the post-op. When you look at the early view, the red arrows here are the bypass flow.
Yeah.
And you've got M1 donor site here. This is our recipient here. And you can see that jet of flow across. So it was actually working just how we wanted it to initially. And you can see that on the different views. But then, and here, this is our Hunterian ligation over here with the clip shutting down the inflow.
How far down, Bas? You sure you didn't get a perforator with the...
Yeah, it was right below the SCA. That's a little foreshortened with the town's view, but it was right below. It was this kind of a deal. But what happened is that the bypass basically isolated this part, and the PCOM, well, actually, That's the bypass isolating that part. The PCOM took over on this side, and then we lost a little bit in here. But she had the stroke and was not too bad off from it. She actually was a little weaker, but got through it.
Do you have the post-op again? Do you see the SCAs now on the post-op? Yeah, very, yeah. Yeah, good thinking. Yeah, I think that's really the only option. Did you do any wrapping of the middle cerebral artery aneurysm?
No, I really wanted to just take care of the one and get out and not take any more risk. But that's the right carotid, and you can see that PCOM doing its work. Yeah, the real trouble is this is a later view, and you just can't turn off the beast once you get it out of the bottle, you know, and the thrombus just keeps going and going. And it was like an avalanche. It just, you know, that was the initial view. You can see, no, that's a later view. But at that point,
I've been through this. Yeah. It's that fine balance between homeostasis, hemostasis, and thrombus.
Yeah.
Trying to keep the little channel open and getting rid of the big one.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. It's almost like you need to have a pause button where you could get the thing going, get it to where you want, and then freeze it. But obviously it doesn't work that way.
I mean, that's the one sort of benefit of plicating the dome when it's still just filled with blood, making the size of the thrombus when it forms so much smaller, or allowing it to be much smaller. Some of those look so bad initially and then really end up doing remarkably well.
It's what's remarkable is that she thrombosed that giant aneurysm and that we didn't get more. I mean, to me, I don't know how you lose your entire P1s both sides and not get a worse MRI scan than that, but she pulled through that. There's the hit right there. Luckily it missed her capsule, but it was close enough to give her a little bit of clinical sign.
Yeah, great case. Tough case.
All right, any questions?